In Indiana, there's a school choice program in which you're working on a case. Tell us about that.
Yeah, this is actually one of the briefs, in addition to the Franchise Act case, that I've actually been working on intensely. And basically what happened recently in Indiana is they passed the largest school choice voucher program in the country to date. And under that program, they provide parents of students, of public school students, a voucher for a small percentage, well, up to 90%, but it varies depending on income, of what the state would have paid to send that child to public school. And then that voucher can be used to send their kid to whatever private or public charter school of their choice. And the reason that the citizens of Indiana enacted this law is, over the years...
This was enacted by initiative?
It was enacted through the legislature.
Legislature, okay.
But it's actually fairly popular in the state, and the reason why is because throughout the country, they've noticed the market-based solutions to this that encourage competition between schools have produced good results. You get higher graduation rates, you get higher test scores.
Welcome to the Libertarian Counterpoint. I'm Richard Fields. On the program today, we have Chance Weldon, who is a College of Public Interest Law Fellow at the Pacific Legal Foundation. And we have Ted Hart, who is the Tea Party Patriots liaison on the California high-speed rail. The California high-speed, well, first of all, let me just tell you where you can watch the show. You can see it on cable at www.accesssacramento.org. That's on the internet, cable channel 17, or your own local cable channel. We're on at 8 p.m. Thursdays, noon Fridays, and 4 a.m. Saturdays, all Pacific time. So tell your friends and neighbors if you don't catch the first show. Ted, the California high-speed rail is supposed to start in September. Will it?
According to
construction, I mean,
Steinberg is pushing it.
Yeah,
there was a meeting Tuesday, and he took the time to actually show up, came in, took over, and said, "We got to get this thing done." And so, it's a question of whether he can push it that far. He has opposition on the other side with some of the senators who are saying, "We haven't had enough time."
I'm curious. Governor Brown just announced the fact that the California budget deficit went from something like $9 billion to $16 billion. This is a $9 billion for the first leg of the of this railroad. Why in the world is California taking on more bond indebtedness, taking on more budgetary responsibilities when they're already in debt to the tune of $16 billion? On an annual basis.
I think the easiest explanation for all of this is, once again, follow the money. And that's what you're suggesting. And basically what it amounts to is, if there was any one thing that I would leave anybody with when we're discussing high-speed rail, is the fact, where's the money?
Okay, where is the money?
The money really is only existent in one place at the present time. The feds have allocated $3.3 billion, and that's sitting for all purposes ready to go, but to be able for the state of California to put their hands on it, they have to agree to some very stringent terms that were set in place. And one of them being is that you have to start the construction of this boondoggle down in the valley. It's got to start. So that's their, what they call their initial operating system, begins at Merced, and at this point they are working to get to Fresno, you might say, and then go on down from there.
Wait a minute, they're talking about a high-speed rail between Merced and Fresno. What's that, 50, 60 miles?
Yeah.
And that's supposed to have ridership?
Well, they said that it was going to be 130 miles. Then what happened the other day is that the matching funds from California, from the bonds that they would then sell to match with the federal fund, they now are going to come up with a $6 billion pot, you might say. And theoretically, they were supposed to be concentrated on 130 miles. The latest discussion is, how far will $6 billion take us? So now they're talking like, well, will it take us 60 miles, 80 miles? They really don't know.
Okay, let's construct a timeline. When did this whole idea get started?
about 30 years ago.
And what got it actually on the drawing board?
In the very beginning, I think just the idea that other people in the world had high-speed rail, and wouldn't that be a great idea?
Okay.
And then it moved forward, and it finally moved up into where the legislature began looking at it some time ago. And as most people know, it finally made its way to the ballot in 2008. And that's where...
What did the voters actually approve in 2008?
In 2008, it was called the Bond Act, $9.95 billion. But again, the actual titling of it, and when you get into the general election, this pamphlet of which the voters had, it's kind of like one of these sales pitches. When you first look at it, it's say, hey, that's, you know, that sounds like a pretty good idea. And at the time, keep in mind, 2008, weren't into the recession at that particular moment, and so it narrowly passed. But what the people were voting on was what they thought, and what it says in here, was a statewide system of 800 miles of high-speed rail. And then there are a lot of requirements for that bond issue to come about, and then where they would, the legislature would say, okay, fine, we're going to go ahead and sell these bonds. And as you get into
it... So no bonds have been sold so far?
No. And that's what they're pressing for right at this particular moment.
So what money has the high-speed rail been operating on if no bonds were sold?
They had money coming in from a grant from the feds. And so far, they've burned through $400 million.
Just
$400 million
just doing plan,
administrative plan, this, that, and other. And so you look at it, and $400 million without a single mile of track down.
Right.
And so everything is in the planning, let's say. But one of the things that I would go to and answer, you know, possibly some of your question as you get into this, and you go back and you begin to study what all of the Prop 1A consisted of, it becomes pretty interesting because you cannot find anywhere a total cost of what the entire statewide system would cost. The Rail Authority has never, ever put that number forward in concrete. They've danced around it, and why I'm getting to that is that when it originally came out, the discussion was this during the voting area, it was going to cost $33 billion.
For
the entire 800 miles. Then, as you got into the pamphlet itself, you come over here, and the analysis by the Legislative Analyst Office is the only place you'll find this, and it says the authority estimated in 2006 the total cost to develop and construct the entire high-speed train system would be about $45 billion. So it's gone from 33 to 45.
In the same pamphlet?
The 33 was a number that was sitting out there that nobody really, it was being pitched as that's what it would be. LAO came along and said, no, we estimate it'll be 45.
Okay, so what the voters voted on was 45.
That's the only place you'll find that number. Now, interestingly enough, since 2006, that number has never been put forward by the Rail Authority. The numbers we're speaking of and the numbers they put forward all have to do with basically the San Francisco to LA. That's where that came from. In addition to that, what makes it difficult for the Rail Authority and what they've been laboring under is the fact that it requires the authority to seek private and other public funds to cover the remaining costs.
Wait a minute, this is above and beyond the $45
billion? No, that what they're saying is that the bond issue of the 9.95, it requires that they go out and find the money.
Oh, okay. So in other words, they're supposed to find another $36 billion.
The primary one that they were counting on and everybody references is the feds.
So they're looking for $36 billion from the feds?
They were looking for at least that until we then move forward and then it jacks up higher. So what happens then is, as you move forward, the rail authority themselves got into, I think, some trouble trying to fit what the requirements of Prop 1A were. And what that consisted of, this is a high-speed rail train, okay? And the last number that they had come out was $98.5 billion. The problem with that is that was the low number. Nobody ever bothered to look at what the high number was. The high number, there was a low and a high, was $117 billion. What happened at that point is Governor Brown stepped in and said, whoa, whoa, wait a minute. We can do better than this. So I'm going to appoint some personal people that I know, and we're going to move them over into that rail authority, and we'll get this thing down, and we're going to reduce the cost of all of this. And so they came in, and the next thing that hit the media was the $68 billion that they have been trumpeting all along. That has a real problem in the sense that, once again, the media always picks up on whatever it's being fed. They, most of the time, they don't take the time to do the investigative reporting. And the other issue that comes with this is that buried in what they call their 2012 revised business plan is one little statement in here, and you got to go find it. It says, if required, a full build option for phase one, is San Francisco, Los Angeles basically, could be completed by 2033 at an incremental cost of $23 billion a year of expenditure dollars for a cumulative cost of $91.4 billion. So what they're saying, and the key words here is if required. Well, if required means again, I'm not the attorney, but if required, we're talking about if required for a halt for a high-speed rail system throughout all 800 miles. If you want to do that, they're telling you that it would cost, just for the LA to San Francisco would be the $91.4 billion. Now, that's only for 520 miles of track. If you then want to say, well, what do we do to get the other 800 to increase this to the full 800, which is the entire system. The only way I know you would do it is you just divide out the numbers by miles and extend it from there. And if you do that, you end up with $140 billion. So these numbers...
So the price has tripled without digging a spade full of earth.
And what they say is that, no, we've come up with this new plan. We have this blended system.
Okay, what's the blended system?
The blended system is to take existing track, as an example, on the peninsula, and they're gonna use that instead of immediately making it a high speed. They're going to use the trains that are traveling San Jose, San Francisco.
Okay, let me make sure that I understand.
Sure.
Is high speed, does that mean, is that electric versus as opposed to diesel?
That's correct. It's totally electrified. It means the tracks have got to be electrified. Everything's got to be set under, again, the requirements back in Prop 1A, and these are the killers, so that you understand exactly what it is. And this, to me, is maybe as important as anything. Under 2704.09, the high-speed train system to be constructed pursuant to this chapter shall be designed to achieve the following characteristics. Electric trains that are capable of a sustained maximum revenue operating speeds of no less than 200 miles an hour. Well, I don't think you're going to find too many trains running up down the peninsula at 200 miles an hour. Otherwise, you better get out of the way. In addition to that, this is the one that is really difficult. These are the requirements. Maximum nonstop service travel times for each corridor that shall not exceed the following. And now they're going to give us times that you can operate. The one running from San Francisco to Los Angeles is 2 hours and 40 minutes. With a blended system, it's questionable whether...
By blended, you mean you have two different trains?
Yeah.
So you'll have a diesel train on existing tracks for part of the route, and then an electric train on an electrified track for the rest of the route.
And they may say...
And you have to switch trains? Or
no, they're going to say that you can get on one and be able to go through. It becomes extremely complicated, but okay, I'm going to give you the easy one.
Are they talking about a locomotive that runs on both diesel and electric? I don't understand.
No. Okay. They're looking at, let me give you the best example. This is the easiest one. What I just said about nonstop service. You then move down to the Sacramento to Los Angeles, 2 hours and 20 minutes. And then you have an achievable operating headway, and that's headway is the time between successive trains, shall be 5 minutes or less. They're running they're zipping out of there in 5 minutes or less. What becomes interesting about the Sacramento issue and San Diego, okay, both of these, is the fact that in their business plan, they're ignoring Sacramento and San Diego, basically. They're saying, when you look in the business plan, they don't even have it included until you dig down, and then they'll say, well, what we're really going to do is we're going to use the existing transportation from Sacramento. So what you would do is you would go over to the Sacramento station, you would get on, in essence, an Amtrak train that would take you to Merced. You would get off in Merced, get on a high-speed train that would take you to Los Angeles. That would be your 2 hours and 20 minutes. That's physically impossible. In other words, to meet these criteria. Then if you want to go to San Diego, you may have the same problem in getting off, getting on, whatever it may be. But what they've done is they've said in basically this, look, the true high-speed train is just too expensive. So we're going to figure out a way to get around it. But we still want to get the money, and we got to get the money, and we're going to figure out some way to get around these requirements. That's their Achilles, enabled to get around these. They claim that they can and that they figured out something. Those of us that have studied their business plan don't see how on earth they would be able to, at least specifically to this Sacramento. In addition to that, what makes it doubly difficult for them, we now get into the question of what's the law as far as what Prop 1A. What did the voters vote for? Going back to what we talked about earlier, the voters voted for an entire statewide system of 800 miles of high-speed trains. Well, those folks in Sacramento area and San Diego, that's not on the horizon for them. I mean, that's basically, it's not there. So the games that go on with this are quite fascinating. And back to your question about $16 billion in the problems that we have within the state of California, how anyone could even look at this and consider this is pretty silly when you really think about it.
Was the cost of the fare and the projected mm-hmm. revenues addressed in the ballot initiative?
In the ballot initiative, it was suggested that the fare would be, again, San Francisco to LA, $51. On the revised business plan, it's $81. Who knows what it really would be?
And did they have a projection of what the revenue would be on what the voters voted on?
No. What they said in simple language is that there would be no operating subsidy, and this is another problem for the rail authority. In here, when you get back into the text of the proposed law, prior to committing any proceeds of bonds described in paragraph 1, so on and so forth, the planned passenger train service to be provided by the authority or pursuant to its authority will not require operating subsidy.
Okay. Is it realistic to assume that there would be no subsidy on something like this, 230 miles
if,
an hour?
If you listen to the politicians, oh yeah, we can do this. And that's based on a lot of numbers that are out there that are all drawn from the European systems. And then when you look at those people who have heavy credentials that have looked at the same thing and said, that's not true. I mean, in other words, you will have to have these subsidies. The rail authority has said for years that that there isn't any operating high-speed train system that requires subsidy. Well, fine. I'm not going to challenge that. There are plenty of other people that can look at that and dig into it and have already done so, and they challenge it. And these are people that, not laymen, okay. One of the other problems is the ridership projections, because that's what generates the money, and so that's what part of your question was. And the problem when you get into these areas, now you're talking about, this is my opinion as to what the ridership will be. The other people say, no, this is what my opinion is. And so you have the loggerheads.
Let me ask you a question that's a little bit off. You may or may not be able to deal with this question, but it takes about an hour to fly from San Francisco mm-hmm. or Sacramento to pretty much anywhere in Southern California. But it takes another hour and a half on the front end and a half an hour on the back end to get through security and mm-hmm. to get your luggage, meaning that you're probably looking at a 4-hour trip in order to make it from one end of the state to the other. Have they considered using screening, using security measures for people boarding this train? Is that part of the plan, or are they just ignoring that?
You know, to be honest, that's one thing that I never bothered to look at. I don't know, they're not screening people getting on Amtrak. I'm going to just throw it out there and say it's questionable.
I'm just wondering if you're talking about screening people, yeah. then you would obviously end up spending an extra hour getting down on the train than you would flying.
One of the, I mean, those of us
for not much of a cost saving,
and those of us that have used like the Capital Expressway going into take the train from here to San Francisco or Emeryville and transfer over. I mean, it's enjoyable. You sit down. I mean, it's relaxing. You got a lot of room and all that good stuff. Now, thinking of, again, Sacramento to L.A., okay, I'm going to go Sacramento to L.A. Well, time-wise, by the time you get through fooling around with what their projection are for the people here in Sacramento, you begin thinking, well, you know, I might just go ahead and still, you know, drive, or I can fly. And what becomes not talked of very much is the fact, fine, I'm taking the train, I get to LA. Well, unless my business is in downtown LA, now I got a problem to get out to Santa Monica, get out in the San Fernando Valley, although the train may stop there, but if you're going somewhere where it's not, which is down toward the beaches, so now you have the same problem. You have the same problem you have with flying. I mean, it doesn't go away.
Yeah.
The only way it goes away is if you're going to drive down there.
And as I understand it, the feel-good argument for the train is that the cost of fuel per passenger mile is supposedly less than driving or flying, and that the amount of pollutants created is lower per passenger mile. Is that accurate, or is that based on very rose-colored glasses estimates on passenger?
It's very much rose-colored glasses, especially in when you start looking at traffic counts and the numbers that they've thrown out there. Again, we're into the he said, they said. Those numbers can all be challenged, and they have been challenged. They've been looked at.
So are they basically projecting, making those kinds of claims based on completely sold out trains?
Pretty much so. I mean, they've got, well, I mean, even if we go back here, if they had to meet the requirements of trains every 5 minutes, I mean, it's just not there.
Is there that many people that go from Northern to Southern California back?
That's the other question. I mean, they'll tell you that there are X number of riders on the coming up through the valley, that it's the second most traveled. I mean, you can just keep rolling numbers out all the time, and they put you to sleep after a while. But I get back, and that's why I have focused, at least from my point of view, have been looking at, okay, let's get out of the realm of he said, they said.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's go back to where is the money coming from?
Okay, where is the money coming from?
Well, as an example, the feds, both in the Senate and the Congress, have passed the fiscal year budget 2013. There is no money in there for high-speed rail.
Now, I understand that a couple of states, Wisconsin, Ohio, Florida, have rejected federal money for high-speed rail because they don't want to get themselves on the hook for their part of the expenses, presumably. And that those monies have been redirected by the Federal Department of Transportation to California. Is that accurate?
Yes, in the sense that they've all rejected it, and it's kind of like, okay, we're throwing that money out on the table, and who wants to pick it up? It's a hot potato with some of the states, and through the great wisdom of our leaders, they said, oh yeah, well, let's take it. That's the $3.3 billion.
Yeah.
They just can't bring themselves to give back. I mean, all these, the other states have recognized that this thing is crazy.
Yeah.
But our people sit there, and for some reason, they have these delusions of grandeur that somehow they're going to get around this. The greatest fear that exists with those senators who have done really good questioning, Sumitian and Lowenthal specifically, keep saying, but what happens if we get started and we can't finish?
Okay, so which brings up the whole environmental issue. Most construction projects, if not all construction projects in the state of California, are vociferously opposed by a number of people. They're opposed by environmentalists for various reasons. They're opposed by people whose property they will cross on eminent domain grounds. They're opposed by whole lot of NIMBY arguments, people who don't want the noise or the unsightliness of something going through their neighborhood. And I'm going to guess that wherever this train ends up being routed, those kinds of problems will exist. Environmental challenges, NIMBY challenges, and eminent domain challenges. Are those being factored in?
They have already been factored in the sense that the rail authority has said, this is where the train's going. You can walk the path down through the San Joaquin Valley. The only current change, not change, but the current one that came up was to whether they're going to take it down through Pacheco Pass. That's where they're going with it. So they pretty much, it's set. So that means those people that are down in the valley, those farmers whose land will be affected by it, they know what's going on. In addition to that, there were challenges in with the cities, more specifically on the peninsula. The cities of three or four of those cities have filed suit against
that. Well, sounds to me like the Big Dig Plan 2, Massachusetts, California following in Massachusetts' footsteps. We'll see where it goes. Thank you very much for being a part of the show. We'll see you again next week, same time, same place, on the Libertarian Counterpoint. Thank you.